All right, I guess we're ready to get started here. This is the topics class, if you're here for the first time, and we're doing a different type of a topic, a different type of a series on the King James Bible. We believe and use the King James Bible to the exclusion of every other version that is out there, and make no apologies for it. Amen. And the reason that we do that is this, what this series of lessons is all about. Now, we've shared with you a number of things in the first three lessons. This is number four tonight. We've shared a number of things with you concerning what is in and what isn't in the modern Bible versions that are out there. Had a few people express great shock to me last week. They said, I could not believe there's all those verses and parts of verses that are missing out of modern versions. Nobody ever told them this before. Isn't it strange that young men are, here we need one over here, Norm. Young men are graduating from Bible school and seminary and so forth, and they never learn about that, and they're told, well, here's a modern up-to-date version, and they're never told what isn't in there. What a shame. Well, tonight we have a different kind of a lesson regarding Bible versions. It's not flashy. It's not spectacular. In fact, maybe it'll bore you. I don't know. Some of you will like it because you're really getting into some of this stuff, and others may not. It may bore you. But it's a very necessary lesson because it goes back to the very root of every Bible version that is out there. Now, you recall we said last week that there's only two kinds of Bibles. One is a King James Bible, and the other is all of the modern versions rolled together, lumped together. Now, explain what we mean by that. But let's begin with a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, as we come to you tonight, we pray that you would bless our study time, open our hearts, open our understandings, even as you did to the disciples on the road to Emmaus, and may the Word of God find a home and a fertile place within our hearts this night. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Okay. How can Bible versions be so different? Many have asked this question, and some of you have asked this question. How can they be so different? Well, you need to remember this, that Satan is a counterfeiter. Everything that God has is good, and Satan has tried to counterfeit it. And that includes the Word of God. All you have to do is read the Scriptures to find that out. You say, somebody said, when did the tampering with the Word of God begin? Well, you read the New Testament and you find it existed right back there in the first century. 2 Corinthians 2:17, Paul says, we are not as many which corrupt the Word of God. So it was going on then. 2 Corinthians 4:2 says that we are not as those that handle the Word of God deceitfully. 2 Peter chapter 3 talks about those that wrest the Scriptures. But you can go back farther than the first century. You go back into Old Testament times. The 23rd chapter of Jeremiah, he wrote about those that pervert the Word of God. In fact, you keep on going back in time until the Garden of Eden itself. And there in the Garden of Eden, we saw five different things happen to the Word of God, and Satan was responsible for it. The very first words in the Bible out of Satan's mouth is to question the Word of God. Genesis 3:1, yea, hath God said. He questioned the Word of God. Did God really say that? So, the fact that Satan is still doing what he did in Genesis chapter 3, adding, subtracting, and changing, and questioning, and denying the Word of God should not be a surprise to anyone. Now, there exists today two different Bible texts. Now, that may also come as a surprise. All the Bibles were not translated from the same Greek or Hebrew manuscripts. there is two distinct, what they call families of manuscripts that exist. One is the one that we get our King James Bible from, and the other is what every Bible that has been translated since 1881, every major Bible translation since 1881 has been translated from this different text. Now, it was never used before 1881. Since then, it has been used exclusively, and the King James Bible was the last Bible translated from the text that it was translated from, and we'll get into this into the lesson. In Acts chapter 11 and verse 26, a new word was coined, and that word was Christian. The disciples were called Christians first in Antioch. As Christianity spread across Asia, Northern Africa, parts of Europe, and so forth, as it was spread, the Word of God grew, and the book of Acts tells us the Word of God grew and was multiplied. Every place where souls were saved and every place a church was established, they needed copies of the Word of God. Now, Paul and other New Testament writers would sit down and they would write as the Holy Spirit moved them. Holy men of God spake as they were moved by the Holy Ghost, 2 Peter 1:21. All scriptures given by inspiration of God, 2 Timothy 3:16. They wrote as the Spirit of God inspired them. That's what you call an original that was written with their own hand or dictated by them personally to a scribe. Well, there was no printing presses in those days. In fact, a printing press was not invented until 1453. And so up until 1453, every copy of the Bible was done by hand. What a laborious thing that was. Everyone was hand copied. And Bibles were pretty expensive. They were pretty precious in those days. Well, they were copied by hand, and every single church had to have copies of Scripture, as well as individuals within that church that could afford them. In the book of Colossians, the 4th chapter, Paul says in the 16th verse, it says, "And when this epistle," that's the epistle to the Colossians, "when this epistle is read among you, cause that it be read also in the church of the Laodiceans." The Laodicean church was not all that far away from Colossae. And he says, "And that ye likewise read the epistle from Laodicea." And so copies of the scriptures were exchanged back there in the first centuries, copied by hand and exchanged, okay? So as the church grew, there had to be more and more copies of the scriptures. Well, Antioch, where the disciples were called Christians, first in Antioch. Antioch, the headquarters of the church. Rome was never the headquarters of the church back there in the first century. You had Jerusalem, where the Jewish believers were, the church at Jerusalem, and you had Antioch. And these were the two regarded as headquarters for the church. And as copies of the scriptures were being made, they circulated from Antioch out into Asia Minor, into Europe, and every place the Word of God was taken, every place that the church was spreading its message. Today, year 2002, we have well over 5,000 hand-copied manuscripts that exist. In fact, I think the count now, if I'm not mistaken, is something like 5,400 and something of manuscripts, ancient manuscripts that date back, not back to the first century. We don't have any in the first century or second century, but we have them that are pretty old, okay? So these were all hand-copied manuscripts. Now, what happened to a manuscript when it would wear out from use? They had to sit down and write another copy by hand. And then, when they finished the copy, they checked it, proofread it, and so forth. Then they destroyed the old manuscript that they had copied it from. So consequently, a lot of these manuscripts were destroyed after the copies were made. So we have copies upon copies upon copies, copies from copies and copies and copies and so forth, right up until 1453 when the printing press was invented. Now, by human standards, that would be a bad thing because people are prone to make errors. We have all kinds of errors. A lot of errors creep into the lesson sheets and into the mountain mover and into the bulletin. And they're all proofread, but, well, for that matter, the Oakland Press as well. You ever see any errors in the Oakland Press? Well, it's all been proofread, but some of them slip by. But we're not talking about a man-made document. We're talking about something that was breathed of God. And God said he would not only inspire his word, but he would preserve it unto all generations. And so the word of God, we don't have to worry about human errors coming in, omissions, additions, corrections, and so forth, because God gave it to us in perfect condition, and he has preserved it in perfect condition as well. Now, all of these Bible texts, or I shouldn't say all of them, there's only really two of them. The one is called the majority text. Now, this is where our King James Bible comes from. It comes right out of the city of Antioch, Syria. That's mentioned here in Acts 11, 26. It's called the majority text because of all of the 5,000 plus manuscripts in existence today, well over 90% of them belong to this same family of manuscripts. They all agree together, agree one with another. This is also called the Byzantine text because this was the text that was used by the Byzantine Church, which is today known as the Eastern Church or the Greek Orthodox or Eastern Orthodox Church and so forth. Well, that was the same ancient text that they used. And it is also called the Textus Receptus. Now, that's a fancy word. First time I saw the word Textus Receptus, I thought it was talking about a dinosaur or something. That's what it sounds like. They give dinosaurs those goofy names. But actually, all it is Latin, and it means the received text. This was the text that the church received from God and has labored to preserve intact as God has directed in it. That is the received text. Now, who used this received text or this Byzantine text or Textus Receptus or whatever you want to call it? Who used it? Well, first of all, we have the church at Antioch. That's where it originated at. That is where the scribes were located that copied the text and so forth. It was later used by the Anabaptist groups who were all over the place. Now, if you're not familiar with the Anabaptists, they were hated and despised by everybody, particularly the Roman Catholic Church. But the Anabaptists were hated because they believed in believer's baptism, didn't believe in sprinkling babies. They believed in baptism by immersion for believers only, and they were hunted down and destroyed, and this is not an exaggeration. They were killed by the millions. In fact, in 1500 and something, a Catholic cardinal said, if we had not slaughtered them to the degree that we did, they would outnumber us. Quite an admission. Well, the Anabaptists, they only recognized one Bible text, and that was what is today called the Textus Receptus. Then that text was also used in the Reformation. Every one of the reformers that rose up and protested against Rome, that's what Protestant means, a Protestant. Everyone that protested against Rome, they used the Bible from what we call today the Textus Receptus, or the majority text. Martin Luther in Germany, he translated the Bible into German, and that began the Reformation over there. And he had access to all of the manuscripts that were available, but he rejected the one family of manuscripts and used only the majority text. The same thing happened in England. William Tyndale, 1526, he translated the Bible into English, and the Reformation was on in England, And so every place, every country in Europe practically, Germany, Switzerland, France, Italy, Holland, they all had a Bible translated into their own language by the Reformers, and it was all from this majority text. Then the Reformations were followed by the Great Awakenings, the Great Age of Revivals. This was the Bible text of the Great Age of Revivals, when men were raised up of God, men like Jonathan Edwards and George Whitefield and John Wesley and all of these men down through the centuries. These great revivals that took place where people trembled when the Word of God was preached. When Jonathan Edwards preached Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God, people hung onto the backs of the pews till their knuckles were white because they were afraid they were going to slip into hell. Well, all that preaching came from the majority family of manuscripts, the Textus Receptus. From this family of manuscripts came every Bible that was printed in English, from the Tyndale Bible in 1526, the Matthew's Bible, the Coverdale Bible, the Geneva Bible, the Bishop's Bible, the Great Bible, and finally, the King James Bible in 1611. The King James Bible was the last Bible, major translation of the Bible, from this text. Okay? So that's our one text here. The second text is what we call the Alexandrian text. The church also moved to the south. They went down into Egypt. Egypt, as you know, is a type of the world. God told the Jews, go not into Egypt. But they did and wound up for 430 years, as slaves in Egypt. Well, Alexandria, Egypt, became the center of the church activity in Egypt. And it was a hotbed of heretics. Men like Origen and others, if you're familiar with any of those names, who began to deliberately corrupt the Word of God. Now, unfortunately, Egypt is a dry, arid place, and many of these manuscripts they continue to exist. They didn't rot away or anything because of the climate. And out of Egypt comes two manuscripts that were older than the majority of the ones that were in existence. Of the 5,000 plus manuscripts, there are two that are considerably older than the rest. Now, these manuscripts, they're called Alexandrian manuscripts, they greatly weaken the deity of Christ, the virgin birth, the second coming, salvation by faith, the Trinity or the Godhead, the preexistence of Christ, the depravity of man, and the resurrection. We go on and on and on. All the key major doctrines, they're terribly, terribly weakened from these manuscripts. They were in many cases intentionally corrupted. In fact, this man Origen, who lived in the fourth century, had a school in which they deliberately corrupted the Word of God. He was a heretic. He believed in all kinds of weird things. We would have called him a New Ager today, if he lived today. And, well, anyways, the Word of God was greatly corrupted. So, therefore, this Alexandrian text was not ever used by anybody until 1881. No one but the Catholic Church ever used it. Nobody. And what did the Catholic Church ever do with the Word of God? Well, in 1229, they banned it completely. And from the 1200s to the 1600s, they murdered anybody they caught with a copy of Scripture or could even quote a verse of Scripture. And so they've never been a friend of the Word of God. Oh, this text was found only used by the Catholic Church. Since 1881, however, every single Bible version, major Bible version, that has been translated comes from that very same Alexandrian text. Now, if you ever wonder why the King James Bible is so different from every other Bible that's out there, that's the reason. Now, from this Alexandrian text. Let's go now. We've seen the two texts. Let's look now at two manuscripts. Two different manuscripts that are the key to this Alexandrian text. One of them is called Vaticanus or Codex B. See, we're getting into some boring stuff here. Vaticanus or Codex B. The other one is called Sinaiticus or ELF. Now, this is scholar talk. They like these big words, and all that means, just disregard the big words. Sinaiticus simply means they found it in a wastebasket to be burned in a monastery at the foot of Mount Sinai. So they give it a scientific name, Sinaiticus. The other one was found in the library in the Vatican. So it got named Vaticanus. And its official names are Codex B and ELF. Very scientific, doesn't it? Are you impressed by all that? Well, don't be. Well, these two were older than most of the other manuscripts that existed, and listen closely, at that time. You know, back in 1953, my great aunt, who was not a Christian, she died. And when my mother was going through her things, she found a box up in her closet. And she opened that box, and it was a first edition 1909 Scofield Reference Bible. Now, why my great aunt bought that, I have no idea. But she did. There it was, first edition, 1909. I wanted the Scofield Bible, you know, and I was so happy when my mother gave it to me. And it was in perfect condition, except the pages were a little bit brittle, but, you know, it still had all the gold around it. Some of the pages kind of stuck together from the gilding around it. The cover was all brand new. And it sat in that box for close to 50 years, okay? It was in perfect condition. Any Bible or book or anything that is old that was never used is going to stay in pretty good condition. Well, they came up with these two manuscripts that were older than the others. Now, I said at that time, because since then, other manuscripts that are far older than those two have been discovered, and they back up the King James Bible. But at any rate, these two manuscripts were discovered, and it was decided that all new Bible translations should come from a family of manuscripts, the Alexandrian family, that are based on those two manuscripts. I mean, they became the final authority. Any new modern Bible version, these two manuscripts became the final authority of what it would say or what it would not say. Now, unfortunately, they did not agree with each other. They don't agree with the King James manuscripts, but they don't agree with each other either. And in the four Gospels alone, this is all in your notes here, they contradict each other. These two manuscripts, Vaticanus, Sinaiticus, they contradict each other. They don't agree together. And in the Gospel of Matthew, they contradict each other 656 times. In Mark, they contradict each other 567 times. In Luke, 791 times, and in John, 1,022 times. For just in the Gospels alone, 3,036 times. They do not agree with each other. They don't agree with the King James manuscripts, but they don't agree with each other either. Now, using the Scofield Reference Bible as kind of a guide, that would figure out to almost 20 contradictions per page in the New Testament. That's a lot. Vaticanus B leaves out words or clauses in Matthew 330 times, in Mark 365 times, in Luke 439 times, in John 357 times, in Acts 384 times, and in the Epistles 681 times, for a total of 2,556 times. That's why so much was missing. Remember the lesson we had last week on omissions? There's the reason, okay? Now, Vaticanus B also omits 2,877 words. They add 536 words, and they change 935 words, which comes to a total of 4,348 words. Now watch this. The other manuscripts, Sinaiticus, they omit 3,455 words. They add 839, and they change 1,114 for a total of 5,480 words, and they're not the same changes. They're not the same changes. They disagree with each other. In fact, one scholar said, as he sat down and checked them out side by side, he said it is easier to find, he says it's harder to find two consecutive verses that agree with each other than disagree. So, in other words, these are not manuscripts preserved by God. Now let's go to the next page. Two witnesses. Well, we got two texts, two manuscripts. Now look at two witnesses. The trial of Jesus, they produced false witnesses. And in Matthew 26, we read that many false witnesses came, yet found they none. And then it says, at the last came two false witnesses. This was at Jesus' trial. And in Mark we read, for many bear false witness against him, but their witness agreed not together. And there arose certain and bear false witness against him, saying, but neither so did their witness agree together. Just like at the trial of Jesus, where they could not get the false witnesses to agree. They were both against Jesus. They both were lying against the Son of God, but they didn't agree together. Well, that's what's happened with these two false witnesses, Vaticanus and Sinaiticus. They're both against the Word of God, but they don't agree together. Now, both in the Old Testament and in the New Testament, we have numerous scriptures where God has set down a principle that at the mouth of two witnesses or three witnesses must every word be established. We got all those verses listed there for you. They come from the New Testament. They come from the Old Testament. It's a principle that runs right through the Word of God, that one person, one witness, could not condemn a person to death. There has to be two witnesses. Well, here we have two witnesses, and there were two witnesses at Jesus' trial. But like at his trial, they did not agree. Now we'll turn the page and watch this. Vaticanus B does not have the book of Revelation, the book of Philippians, the book of Titus, or 1st or 2nd Timothy. Also large parts of Samuel, Kings, Nehemiah, Psalms, Genesis, plus key parts of Mark and Luke are omitted. However, what they do have is Bel and the Dragon, Tobit, book of Tobit, the book of Judith, the epistle of Barnabas, and the shepherd of Hermes, all added to the scriptures. It was about a century or so later that the Catholic Church canonized those books and said they're part of the Word of God. Nobody ever considered them part of the Word of God, but yet here they were in Vaticanus B. Now, this family of manuscripts, they were not used for 1,300 years of church history. B and Alph, if you take the two together, there's 8,000 changes in B and 9,000 changes in Alph, and they're not the same changes. You take the two together and you got 13,000 places. It averages out to two changes per verse, and they disagree with each other a dozen times per page. And so in spite of the errors, the additions, subtractions, and changes, and contradictions, and corrections in these two manuscripts, they have become the foundation for every modern Bible version that is out there. You see why Jesus said, beware of the scribes. It says, the same shall receive greater damnation. And we saw that last time, how tampering with the Word of God brings the judgment and damnation of God upon you. Well, now down at the bottom of your page here, anyways, we have two quotations here. One is from the preface of the New Good News Translation. The other is from Louis Farrakhan of the Nation of Islam in an article, What Muslims Believe. Now, that's about as far opposite as you can get. I want you to see what both of them are saying. First of all, the scholars from the Good News Translation said, to help English readers accurately understand what was originally written. Now, right away, when they use the word originally, that means you do not believe that this we have here, what was originally written. To help modern believers understand what was originally written requires the help of scholars or the modern day scribes. It says, you folks are too dumb to understand this book, but the scholars will meet together and we'll tell you what it really says. Interpret it for you. We'll show you where parts of it must have got lost and all of that nonsense. Louis Farrakhan, he said, we believe in the truth of the Bible, but we believe that it has been tampered with and must be reinterpreted so that mankind will not be snared by the falsehood that have been added to it. He believes that there's been things changed, it's been tampered with, and has been added to. Now, what both of these two people are saying, they're both lost unbelievers. One is a professing Christian and the other is a Muslim. But what they're both saying is we do not have what was originally written. They don't believe that. They believe the Bible has been tampered with. Well, I want you to rest your hearts and souls in the fact that the Word of God, which you have to take by faith, God said He will preserve His Word perfect unto all generations. The Word of God was given as a pure Word of God. We read that many times in the Scriptures. And God said He would preserve it to our children and our children's children and all of every generation thereafter. We also have that in the Scripture many times. And so they're both saying that we need the scholars to tell us what is the Word of God and what isn't the Word of God. Well, the scholars are very willing to do that. If you turn the page, this is from a book called New Age Versions, page 548. Here's what just a few of modern day scholars tell us. First of all, Edwin Palmer, executive secretary of the NIV committee, he's dead now, just died here a couple, 3 years ago. He said, Alf and B, at Sinaiticus and Vaticanus, are more reliable and accurate. I mean, they contradict themselves thousands of times. But he says, they're more reliable and accurate. Do you know what else he said? He said, Jesus never claimed to be God. He didn't believe in the deity of Christ. He was the head of the NIV translating committee. Here's Ronald Youngblood. He's another NIV translating committee member. He said, the readings found in Vaticanus B and Sinaiticus Alf of the 4th century A.D. are to be preferred, and a colleague of his, Kenneth L. Barker, agreed with him on the same thing. J.B. Phillips, you may have heard of him. He came out with his own Bible translation in the 40s and 50s called Phillips Translation. He said, he's also the author of the foreword in the New American Standard Interlinear. He's got his fingers in a lot of different Bible versions. He said, it is the most reliable Greek text, talking about Alpha and B there. You know what else he said? He said, Bible-believing fundamentalists are a bunch of putrid, fire-breathing asses. And he believed in communicating with the dead. But he translated his own version of the Bible, and he was used on other Bible translation committees. Louis Foster, member of, and here's a guy with his foot in two worlds, member of both the New King James Committee and the NIV Committee, he said, the most highly valued manuscripts and the most dependable are the Codex Vaticanus and the Sinaiticus. And then finally, the introduction to Nestle's Greek New Testament, it said, the use of Alpha and B as a basis for its text, saying the precedent of the Vaticanus will be justified. Well, why are all these men, they're lost, there's no question about it, they're lost sinners. Why are all these men backing those two manuscripts that are so terribly, been so terribly corrupted? And those two manuscripts that form the basis of everything, of every one of these modern translations. Well, for the same reason that there's multitudes of people out there that are believing in evolution as opposed to creation without a shred of evidence to back it up. It's the big satanic lie. Now, if you go to the next page, we're going to see an example of the scholarship in action here. And here's how it works. In the first chapter of Mark, we read that the beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophets, "Behold, I send my messenger before thy face, which shall prepare thy way before thee. The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord and make straight his paths." We're going to look at that translation, or we're going to look at that verse, two verses there, in modern translations. Now, before we do that, if you look right up at the top of the page, see where it says Malachi 3? It says, "Behold, I will send my messenger, and he shall prepare the way before me." This is a prophecy of John the Baptist from the book of Malachi. Right next to it, where it says Isaiah 40, here's another prophecy of John the Baptist from the book of Isaiah. "The voice of him that crieth in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord, make straight in the desert a highway for our God." Now, way back in the 4th century someplace, some scribe decided he is going to make some changes. He's going to do some corrections, or he's going to what he thinks should go in here. Now watch what it says. "The beginning of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, as it is written in the prophets." And then it quotes first Malachi, "I send my messenger before thy face," and then Isaiah, "The voice of one crying in the wilderness, prepare ye the way of the Lord." Check that out in a modern Bible version. You don't need to be a scholar to know what's right from wrong here. A third grader can tell you which is correct and which is not correct. We're going to start here we're not going to read all these, but they're all there for you. The Amplified Bible says, "The beginning of the facts of the good news of the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Son of God, just as it is written in the prophet Isaiah, 'Behold, I send my messenger before your face.'" Wait a minute. That's not the prophet Isaiah. That's Malachi. Look right up at the top of the page. "Behold, I will send my messenger." That's Malachi that said that. Isaiah never said that. But there was an obvious error or correction in these corrupted manuscripts. And so where the King James Bible says "in the prophets," they changed it to Isaiah. The only problem is it wasn't Isaiah. It was Malachi. And then the next verse is what was quoted in Isaiah. Now that is obvious, right? I mean, how can you miss that? But here's the way scholarship works. Every version that has come out has given Malachi credit for saying, "Behold, I will send my messenger." Read them all. We got them all here. The New American Standard, the NIV, the New Revised Standard. We got a bunch of them in here. There's 12 of them all together. Plus, there's one more on the next page. On the next page is the same passage in The Message, which is the 2002 translation that just came out. It says, "The good news of Jesus Christ, the message begins here, following the letter, the scroll of the prophet Isaiah," and then he goes into that, "Watch closely, I'm sending my preacher ahead of you, he'll make the road smooth," and so forth. Every one of these is deliberately printing an error. They know it's an error. But why are they doing it? Well, because it's in the what used to be the two oldest manuscripts, upon which every single thing in a modern Bible version is based upon. That's modern day scholarship. Now, when the church was using the Textus Receptus and nothing else, the Protestant church, the Anabaptists, the Reformers, the Revivalists, and so forth, there was never a problem like this. Here's Tyndale's translation, 1526. He says, "As it is written in the prophets." The same with Matthew's Bible. The Geneva Bible, as it is written in the prophets. Young's literal translation of 1898 says the very same thing. And it was never, never, ever a problem until they started using a different manuscript with an obvious error in it that they refused to correct. Now, on the next pages, the next two pages, we've taken some excerpts here out of a book called Purified Seven Times. It's about the King James Bible. And the author states, "The King James Bible was the last major English translation of the scriptures to be based solely on the Textus Receptus or the received text. It goes on and says there has not been one popular English translation of the Bible produced after the King James Bible that came from the true Bible text, not one. Then he goes on and says every modern English Bible produced since the 1885 Revised Version comes from the perverted, corrupted text fabricated by Westcott and Hort, or at least borrows heavily from it. Any Bible produced since 1885 is not a Bible at all, but an erroneous departure from the Word of God. Do not settle for the devil's counterfeit. And then on the next verse, he says some other things that we're not going to take time to read it because we've got a lot to do here, but you can read it at your leisure. All right, we have seen then the two texts. We've seen the two witnesses. Now we want to see the two techniques. The technique of translating a Bible. Did you know there's more than one? There's two different techniques. One is called formal equivalency, and the other is called dynamic equivalency. Now, don't let the big terms scare you. Formal equivalency simply means you translate literally. What is written in the Hebrew or in the Greek, you translate it literally into the English. Dynamic equivalency says, we don't translate literally. We translate thoughts, not words. The NIV and almost every other one that's out there has been translated using dynamic equivalency, in which they have said that they just translate thoughts. Now, this is a dangerous thing to get into because that throws the Bible right open to interpretation. It's not translation, it's interpretation. And if you got a bunch of lost men that are translating the Bible, what they're doing is interpreting and translating at the same time. Now, we're going to take an obscure verse of Scripture. And this is really kind of funny, except that it's so serious to tamper with the Word of God. But in Judges chapter 5 and verse 14, it's right at the end of the verse, it says, the pen of the writer. See that, where it's underlined? The pen of the writer. This is the Song of Deborah, where her and Barak, they're defeating the enemies of Israel there as they're conquering the land. So they write here, it's no big deal, the pen of the writer. Well, that's the way the Bible has read ever since the time of Deborah and Barak, the pen of the writer. Now remember, from 1611, when the King James Bible was translated, to 1881, 1885 for the Old Testament, of the Revised Version, there was no major Bible translation for 270 years. Okay, from 1611 to 1885. There was no major Bible translation took place at all. Now in that interval, 1611 to 1885, the science of archaeology came up with what they thought was some amazing news. They said that writing was unknown to the human race in the time of Moses. This is what was believed. In the time of Moses, writing was unknown. They believed that for a number of years. I don't know how they figured that Moses got the Ten Commandments, if there was no writing, but I guess that didn't bother them. So anyways, in 1885 for the Old Testament here, the first new translation comes out, and so when Judges 5:14 says, the pen of the writer, they said, we can't do that. That's what the Hebrew text said, the pen of the writer. But we can't translate it, the pen of the writer. Science says writing was unknown back then. So we got to do something with it. Now, this is dynamic equivalency, okay? We're going to translate thoughts. We're going to think like God must have been thinking. Somebody made a mistake there. They put in pen of the writer, okay? But we're going to try to do it like God, think like God thinks here. So they changed it to read the staff of the marshal. That's a military term. The staff of the marshal. So what used to be pen of the writer now became staff of the marshal. Well, that Bible came out in 1885. And God has his little jokes, I'm sure. 2 years later, in 1887, the discovery of the Tell el-Amarna tablets put writing back to about 100 years before Moses lived. Uh-oh. Somebody boo-booed in this Bible. They were trying to be scientifically correct, and they changed the Word of God to be scientifically correct, and now they find out writing goes back that far. And then in 1901, they discovered the code of Hammurabi, putting writing back before the time of Abraham. And then in 1904, another great discovery was made, finding out that writing went way back even before Abraham amongst the Canaanites, Phoenicians, Arabians, and Greeks, and so forth. So what happened to this scientifically altered Bible that wanted to be scientifically correct? Well, it disappeared from view. They sold millions of copies, 2 or 3 million of copies when it first came out, but stuff like this soon caused it to go sink into oblivion, and it wasn't used by anybody. Heralded with great fanfare, so it completely disappeared. Or did it? Or did it? Now we said, if you go to the next page, there's dangers from this method. Big dangers. First of all, Isaiah said, "My thoughts are not your thoughts." They say, "We don't translate literal words, we translate thoughts." Well, right away, it's flawed, because God says, "My thoughts are not your thoughts." And Jesus said that we're going to live, the man is to live not by bread alone, but by every word of God. Not every thought of God, but every word of God. And in Deuteronomy and in Exodus and throughout the Scripture talks about God saying, "Observe and hear all these words, not thoughts, words." The words are what are important. God says, "Don't change any of the words. Preserve those words because they're the words of God. They're not the thoughts of God. They're much more than that. They are the words of God." And even there in Exodus 34:28. It's the end of the verse. He says, "He wrote upon the tables the words of the covenant, the Ten Commandments." They were the words of God, not God's thoughts. They were his words. So the pen of the writer was changed simply because scientific thought of that day said writing didn't exist. Now, if you go back into time, here's the Septuagint. That was a Hebrew, that was for Jews. It was the Hebrew scriptures were translated into Greek. That's what the Septuagint is. Okay. It's around 200 BC. They translated that the scribe's pen. They didn't have a problem with it because they didn't know what science was doing in that field. And then you go back to around the second century, the Eastern text, the Peshitta, which lines right up with the Textus Receptus. It's a Bible used by the Eastern Church. They translated that, the pen of a scribe. 1526, Tyndale translated that, the pen of the scribe. And then 1560, the Geneva Bible translated it, the pen of the writer, just like the King James did. And then finally, 1611, the King James Bible says the pen of the writer. And Young's literal translation, which was not ever translated for common use, is translated the reed of a writer. Now that's all formal equivalency, translating exactly what is said. Let's go to the next page and look right there at the top of the page. There's our postage stamp that we used last week, the Century of Progress. Here is the century of progress given to us by the modern day scribes of what they have done to the Word of God. The pen of the writer in 1885 was changed to the staff of a marshal because they didn't believe writing was invented yet. Now by 1901, they knew that was wrong. The American Standard Version came out in 1901. But the American Standard Version was a first cousin to the English Revised Version. They actually worked together on it, and the American Version came out 20 years later, but they were closely connected. And so the American Standard Version, they knew by this time that it was wrong, but they did it anyways. They translated it the Marshall Staff. The one said the staff of a marshal, the other said the marshal's staff. And then 59 years later, the New American Standard came out and they called it the staff of office. And notice they put a footnote in there, right down at the bottom of the page, it says literally the scribe. Well, if it was literally the scribe, why didn't they say it? But they called it office. We're coming back to this, don't worry, if you have a question. 1971, out comes the NIV, and they called it the commander's staff. The New Century Version came out in 1987, and they called it those who lead. Now, is anybody picking up anything, the slightest hint that this is talking about the pen of a writer? Not a bit. 1989, the Revised English Bible calls it the musterer's staff, whatever that is. And in 1995, the Contemporary English Version just chopped the bottom of the verse right off, didn't even incorporate it. In 1996, the New Living Translation called it the rod of authority. And then in 2001, the English Standard Version came out, and they called it the lieutenant's staff. Now, in the Good News Translation of 2001 and the Message of 2002, they both just chop the end of the verse off and don't even include the whole end of the verse. So this is what modern-day scholarship has done. The New King James, which some of you think must be a great translation, it's not, came out in 1979, they call it the recruiter's staff, okay? Why? When they obviously knew what it meant. I mean, they know what those words mean. Go to the next page. Here's the New American Standard again. And right down at the bottom there, it says the staff of office, right at the bottom of verse 14. The staff of office, it should be the pen of the writer, but they call it the staff of office. What's under that is the New American Standard Exhaustive Concordance. And we learn there that the word writer is this Hebrew word, sofer. It's found 53 times in the Old Testament. And then what's under that is how the New American Standard translated this word. One time they translated it as learned. One time they translated it as office. That's right here in Judges 5:14. And then 39 times they translated it as scribe. Twice they translated it scribes. Five times they translated it scribes without the apostrophe. Once secretaries, twice secretary, once writer, and twice writing. They knew what that word meant. But they wanted to be politically and scientifically correct. In fact, in the New American Standard Version, Psalm 45 and Ezekiel 9, it has that word three times in which they did translate it writer. Same word, but they changed it to a staff of office. Go to the next page. Now, on the next page, we have the same thing from the NIV. The NIV called it the commander's staff. And what's under that is the NIV concordance. And here's how they translated that word these 53 times. Secretary, 28 times. Scribe, 11 times. Secretaries, 4 times. Scribes, 2 times, and so forth. One time they translated it commander. Right here. Because they wanted to be scientifically correct. You see how these people build on each other's errors? They just keep building on them. They don't correct them. They just build on them and continue to build on them. That is dynamic equivalency. So it's kind of like doctors. You know, they say a doctor won't criticize another doctor. Well, a translator won't criticize another translator. And they translated the same word writer in Psalm 45 and twice in Ezekiel 9, but would not do it here, where the obvious meaning is the pen of the writer. Now, there's one more thing we want to share with you, and that's the last 12 verses of Mark. Now, that's serious. Any tampering with the Word of God is serious, but this is far more serious. We are told that the last 12 verses of the last chapter of Mark don't belong there. Modern Bible versions, based on a bad text, based on two manuscripts that do not agree, translated by an unscriptural method, and translated for the most part by unbelievers. All right, let's go to the next one. We had Mark 1:1 and 2, and then Mark 16:8. Here's where we are. We're down the last one here. Mark 16:8. According to the scholars, the scribes, that should be the last verse in the Gospel of Mark. Look how it reads. They went out quickly and fled from the sepulcher, for they trembled and were amazed. Neither said they anything to any man, for they were afraid. And according to the scholars, that's the last verse in the Gospel of Mark. The last 12 verses don't belong there. They were added. Now, the Bible says that false prophets will arise and deceive many. Now, this may come as a shock, but we have, that I say we, the church has, 620 ancient manuscripts of the Gospel of Mark. Of those 5,400 that the church has, 620 of them are the Gospel of Mark. In 618 of them, the last 12 verses of Mark are found. Only two leave it out. Guess which two? Sinaiticus and Vaticanus. They're the only two that leave that out. Now, there's a little chart on the bottom of this page, and this is the evidence against Mark 16, 9 through 20, Codex B, which is Vaticanus, and Codex Alph, which is Sinaiticus, and that's it. Just those two. On the next page, there's another chart, 29 ancient witnesses, which you'll notice goes all the way back to the second century in favor of those 12 verses being in there. Now, what I want to, we want to close with this, I want to show you the deceit in the modern day translators concerning those last 12 verses. Each one of on the chart on the next page where it says, beware of the scribes, in the left-hand column is a modern day translation, and in the right-hand column is what they say about those 12 verses. Now remember, there's only two manuscripts that don't have them, okay? You see if you can recognize deceit when you see it. First of all, the good news for modern man says some manuscripts and ancient translations do not have this ending of the gospel, verses 9 through 20. Now, do you see any deceit in there? It says there's some that don't have it. Yeah. 618 do and two don't. But some don't have it. Here's the NIV. The NIV did something a little different here. They said the two most reliable early manuscripts do not have Mark 16, 9 through 20. The two most reliable. They tell you there's only two, but they say they're the most reliable. These are the manuscripts that contradict each other in 13,000 places that they call the most reliable. The New American Standard says some of the oldest manuscripts do not contain this. New Revised Version, some of the most ancient authorities bring the book to a close at the end of verse 8. The Message says Mark 16, 9 through 20 is contained only in later manuscripts. Now, that was written in 1993. It says it's found only in later manuscripts. That's a deliberate lie, because by 1993 they knew that there were far more ancient manuscripts going all the way back to the second century that had that in it. But they're not going to tell you that. The Revised English Bible says, at this point, some of the most ancient witnesses bring the book to a close. The Contemporary English Version says verse 9 to 20 are not in some manuscripts. They don't say two, some. Translation called God's Word says some manuscripts and translations end here, and then goes on to say some add verses 9 through 20. Some add verses 9 through 20. Yeah, 618 different manuscripts add verses 9 through 20. The New King James says verses 9 to 20 are bracketed in the New Text as not original, and it says they are lacking in Codex Sinaiticus and Vaticanus, although nearly all other manuscripts of Mark contain them. But notice the way that's worded. It's worded to cause you doubt whether it really does believe there. God's New Covenant says the longer ending of verses 9 through 20 is not part of the gospel. The New Jerusalem Bible says originally Mark probably ended abruptly on this note of awe and wonder. A note of awe and wonder? Bunch of trembling, scared, stiff disciples? What a way to bring a book to a close, that it ended in awe and wonder, and it goes on. And it says here, the next 12 verses missing in some manuscripts, two of them, are a summary of material gathered from other New Testament writings, and that's just a flat-out lie. what's written in those last 12 verses, for the most part, you don't find written in any other New Testament manuscript, any one of the other Gospels. So that is just a flat-out lie. There's no summary of anything. And then even the Jehovah's Witnesses, we put them in there. They say certain ancient manuscripts and versions add the following long conclusion, and it's not an addition. It's what God put in there. So this is modern scholarship in action. This is their technique. This is their texts. This is their key witnesses in the matter. Our time is gone, and we're going to have to stop. But next week, we're going to be continuing on in these same thoughts. And next week, we want to deal, not exclusively, but for the most part, with the resurrection of Jesus. What has happened to the resurrection of Jesus the virgin birth. What has happened to the virgin birth of Jesus in these modern translations? If Jesus was not born of a virgin, he is not God. And if he's not God, he couldn't die for your sins. Be senseless. He'd be just an ordinary man dying. So the virgin birth is a very important doctrine. We're going to see what happens to it next time. Let's pray together. Loving Father, dismiss us with your blessing resting upon us. We pray, Lord, that you would open our hearts and our understanding and our appetites to study these things and be like the Bereans, who thy word tells us, search the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. Dismiss us with your blessing now in Jesus' name. Amen. Thanks for coming.